Good morning, New Egypt and Cookstown UMC. I am so excited to be with you all this morning. Though we may each be in our own houses, we are here together as one in the spirit. Please feel free to say good morning to one another in the comment section of the videos. And as you do, I ask that you would also join me in worship as we sing this morning, Because He Lives.
Fear is gone because
This morning we are going to say a unison prayer together. The words will also be on the screen, but before we do that, I wanted to let each of you know that if you have any prayer requests, to please feel free to send a private message to either Facebook page, or you can send a message to me directly. I will be giving you my email later on in this service. I would love to pray for you and with you, and we have a group of prayer warriors that will gladly lift your requests to God as well. Let us pray. God, we bring our stories to this place, and we wait to be held by yours. We bring our faithfulness, shape it with grace. We bring our success, shape it with generosity. We bring our weaknesses, shape them with compassion. We bring our possibilities, shape them with hope. We confess, God, that the way is hard and we are tired. We confess that the way is unclear and we do not know the path. Speak into our wandering with your story of vision. We confess that we are tired of waiting. We just want to make it happen. Speak to our impatience with your story of wisdom. Let your story be our story. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, kids. It's Miss Julie. How are you doing today? Well, I love the game Guess Who. And guess what? I found it. I went to the dollar store the other day and I found it. There it was on the shelf. It's my favorite game. So I bought it. I can't explain it. All I know is that when I went to the dollar store, there it was, and I bought it. And now I have my favorite game right at home with me. It's so exciting. You know what? It made me think of a really good Bible story. And it's the story of the blind man. And so this blind man met Jesus, and Jesus took some mud and he spit on it and he rubbed it on his eyes. And all of a sudden, the blind man could see. He was healed. And when they asked the blind man all about it, like who healed him and how did he heal? He couldn't explain it. And he said, all I know is that once I was blind, but now I can see. And as Christians, there's some things that we just can't explain, and that's okay. All I know is that Jesus loves me, and I belong to him. And that's easy. That's all we need to know. All right, guys. Well, that's it for now. Miss Julie signing off. I'll see you soon. Have a great week.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading is found in the book of John, chapter 9, verses 1 through 12. May God's blessing be upon the reading and hearing of these words. Walking down the street, Jesus saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, causing him to be born blind? Jesus said, you're asking the wrong question. You're looking for someone to blame. There is no such cause and effect here. Look instead for what God can do. We need to be energetically at work for the one who sent me here, working while the sun shines. When night falls, the workday is over. For as long as I'm in the world, there's plenty of light. I am the world's light. He said this and then spit in the dust, made a clay paste with the saliva, rubbed the paste on the blind man's eyes, and said, go and wash in the pool of Siloam. Siloam means sent. The man went and washed and saw. Soon the town was buzzing. His relatives and those who year after year had seen him as a blind man begging were saying, why, isn't this the man we knew who sat here and begged? Others said, it's him, all right. But others objected. It's not the same man at all. It just looks like him. He said, it's me, the very one. They said, how did your eyes get opened? A man named Jesus made a paste and rubbed it on my eyes and told me, go to Siloam and wash. I did what he said. When I washed, I saw. So where is he? I don't know. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning again, family. I'm so happy to be with you this morning and to share the word. Since it is my first Sunday with all of you, I thought speaking about stories would be a good place to start. This way you can hear some of my story. We can look at a story directly from the Word of God in John 9. And also, we can hear some of John Wesley's story as well. Did you know that John Wesley was originally a priest with the Church of England, but it wasn't until he had what he called his Aldersgate experience that he felt his life truly changed? Here's a quote from his story. In the evening, I went very unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street, where one was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle of Romans. About a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith in Christ, I felt my heart being strangely warmed. I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation. An assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. A few weeks later, Wesley preached a sermon on the doctrine of personal salvation by faith, which was followed by another on God's grace, free in all and free for all. Because of this moment in time, because of this story of the Holy Spirit working through John Wesley, you have found yourself joining a Methodist community this morning. Our scripture reading this morning from John was an Aldersgate moment of sorts as well. This morning's reading was from the Message Bible. I want you to know that I do not always preach from the Message version of the Bible, but I really liked the way the story was laid out. So that's why I chose to use it this morning. The heading in one of my Bibles labeled this story as True Blindness. I feel like it was labeled that because there's such a difference between knowing of Christ but not really knowing Christ. So let's get into the word this morning. Walking down the street, Jesus saw a blind man from birth. His disciples asked, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, causing them to be blind?" I need you to know this morning that sometimes we as people, we look and we only see what's right in front of us. We don't necessarily see what a person has been through, what a person could possibly be. We need to remember that people are more than just what we see with what meets the eye. Jesus then said, "You're asking the wrong question. You're looking for someone to blame. There is no such cause and effect here. Look instead for what God can do. We need to be energetically at work for the one who sent me here. Working while the sun shines. When night falls, the workday is over. For as long as I am in the world, there is plenty of light. I'm the world's light." Jesus tells his friends, look at what God can do for a person and how they all need to be energetically at work for God who sent Jesus here. And the same goes for us. He tells them, as long as he, Jesus, is in the world, there will be light. But we need to remember that during the Beatitudes, Jesus tells us that we are the light of the world. Incarnate Jesus may no longer walk among us, but he has sent his Holy Spirit, which we'll talk about more next week. And as Christians, we are the literal embodiment of Jesus with skin on. Let that sink in for a second. He said this, and then he spit in the dust, made a clay paste with the saliva, and rubbed that paste on the blind man's eyes. And he said, "Go and wash at the pool of Siloam." Siloam means sent. And the man went and washed, and he saw. Just like that man in this story, while we may not be physically blind, We have all been spiritually blind at some point in our lives, spiritually ignorant to Christ. But like this man, when we accept Jesus as our personal Savior, we are also sent. While we were not told to watch in the pool of Siloam, which means sent, we have been sent to reach the world. The Great Commission tells us to go. Soon, the town was buzzing. His relatives and those who year after year had seen him as a blind man begging were saying, "Why, isn't this the man we knew who sat here and begged?" Others said, "It's him, all right." Others objected, "It's not the same man at all. It just looks like him." He said, "It's me, everyone. The very one." Take a look at how many people were actually touched by this story. How many lives have been impacted? His relatives, the whole town, his parents, the Pharisees, the disciples, and who knows how many more those people went and told beyond that. When Jesus is at the center of our story, it literally can change lives. I love the phrase they say when they say, "Is this the man we knew?" That is prophetic stuff. When we encounter Christ, things change. People change. Things can be made new. In verse 10, it says, they said, "How did your eyes get open?" "A man named Jesus made a paste and rubbed it on my eyes and told me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' I did what he said. When I washed, I saw." So where is he? I don't know. This man didn't know Jesus yet, but he knew he had a life-altering moment. I had an Aldersgate moment of sorts, a life-altering moment on my first trip to the Dominican Republic. The church tradition I was raised in was very different than the Methodist church. There were a lot of very specific ideas of what a good Christian looked and acted like. When I was diagnosed with this rare liver disease, it caused me to question many things I believed. People I loved and I thought loved me would say things like, "Well, you just need to have more faith. You don't have liver disease, you're healed." This commentary made me feel very insecure. It made me doubtful, and most of all, it made me angry. I felt very alienated from God, and after a 6-year wait, I did receive the gift of life through a liver transplant. But my relationship with God was very strained for many years after that. I continued to question the love God had for me and what his purpose was in my life. So flashback to 2017. My pastor at the time was talking about this missions trip he was going to go on in the Dominican Republic. From the moment I heard about that trip, I knew I wanted to go, but my finances at the time were not going to allow me to do that. However, my pastor made it very clear to me that if I felt the Holy Spirit leading me to go, then I was going. As I headed to the airport for that trip, I just prayed a very simple prayer that, "God, whatever you ask of me during this trip, my answer is yes." On our last day, we pulled together this little pickup game of baseball with some of the community kids in the area that we were building the house. And I will never forget standing in the middle of that baseball field. It was what felt like a million degrees. I was dirty, there were bugs, and as you get to know me, you will know that there are few things that I really dislike, and that is sweating, bugs, and dirt. But even in that moment, it was like time stood still in a way. The sun was beating down heavy, and it came to me, kind of like Wesley, like an aha moment. God, this is what your love is like. Up until that point, I had always heard God's love explained to me in this very ethereal way that just didn't resonate with me in any way. And I realized, standing in that field that day, that the love of God can be messy, And dirty. I mean, look, he put mud on the man's eyes in the story we just read. But it's also full of laughter and joy and community. And it has always been about loving God and loving others. And when you do, that love of God is so real and so evident. God changed my heart that day during that game of baseball. And that is what became the catalyst for me to continue to say yes many more times, including my call into ministry, which is why I'm preaching here with you today. As we move on to this next section of scripture, remember that life with Jesus is beautiful, but it is also challenging at times. People will want to know why your life is different. Now, this next section of scripture further down was not part of our reading this morning, but it is so important. We're going to start in verse 24. It says, "They called the man back a second time who had been blind and told him, 'Give credit to God. We know this man is an impostor.' He replied, 'I know nothing about that one way or the other. But I know one thing for sure. I was blind, but now I see.'" This is an incredible story, and this is all our story. At one point in time, we did not know Jesus, but now we do. Maybe you're joining church for the first time today and didn't know about Jesus until this very moment. Maybe this moment, right now, is the moment you encounter Christ. With that, they jumped all over him. You might be a disciple of that man, but we're disciples of Moses. We know for sure that God spoke to Moses, but we have no idea where this man comes from. The man replied, "This is amazing. You claim to know nothing about him, but the fact is he opened my eyes. It is well known that God is not at the beck and call of sinners, but listens carefully to anyone who lives in reverence and does his will. That someone opened the eyes of a man born blind has never been heard of, ever. If this man didn't come from God, he wouldn't be able to do anything." The next section of scripture right here, this moment, is so important, even more so than the fact that he was no longer physically blind. It's that he's no longer spiritually blind. Verse 35, "Jesus heard that they had thrown him out and went and found him." I love that Jesus goes and finds us. "He asked him, 'Do you believe in the Son of Man?' The man said, 'Point him out to me, sir, so that I can believe in him.' Jesus said, 'You're looking right at him. Don't you recognize my voice?' 'Master, I believe,' the man said, and he worshiped." Each of us have had moments where we have felt the nearness of God, where we have changed in some way, where we once were blind, but now we see. If you feel you've never had a moment like that, I encourage you to go back and look at some of the stories in your life where you felt like you were alone. Look at all the little details. I remember some of the time that I went through being sick and I felt like the Lord was nowhere to be found. But hindsight is 20/20. There were so many instances that one day I'll share more with you where it was so obvious the Lord's hand was at work. But I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Those moments are worthy of sharing. These moments, through the power of the Holy Spirit, may even be the stories that cause someone else to have an Aldersgate experience. Share your story of what Jesus has done for you. He has given you a life worth sharing. This is one way to make disciples and transform the world. As these weeks progress, I cannot wait to speak with you and hear some of your stories of transformation. God is so good. Amen. Amen. This is the time that we would normally take our tithes and offerings if we were in our buildings. I want to thank each and every one of you who have continued to give during such an uncertain time. It is because of you ministry can continue at New Egypt and Cookstown UMCs. If you have not been able to give, please know that we are praying for you. We know that jobs and many things are very, very unstable at this time, so please know that you are in our prayers. As of now, you can still give to both churches via the regular mail, and I'll have the addresses listed right here on the side. You can also give to New Egypt UMC via PayPal with the address listed here. And we are currently working on getting Cookstown a PayPal as well. Until then, mailing your tithes and offerings is just fine. Let us pray. Great God, we thank you so very much for your abundance during this crazy time of COVID-19. We thank you that ministry can and will continue at both of your churches. God, we thank you that your hand of blessing is upon us. And Lord, for those that are struggling, God, we ask that you would pour an extra blessing on them as well. That you would restore their jobs that may be lost, and that you would be their hope and their help and their comfort during this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Before we close this morning, I wanted to give you an update on a few things. One, next week we will be studying Pentecost. Following that, for the month of June, we will begin a study called Move Mountains. I would also like to offer a small group via Zoom during the month of June as well that goes along with Move Mountains. If you are interested in this study, you can email me right here, or you can also private message the Facebook pages. I would love to know if, one, you would prefer a morning study from 11 to 12, or if an evening study would be better, something like 7 to 8. If we get enough people, I will gladly offer both times. So please let me know what you would feel the most comfortable with, what would be best for you, and then we will go from there. And lastly, I know many of you have seen that our president has urged strongly that governors reopen all churches because they are essential. I am elated to see our government recognize that the work we do as the church is essential, especially during this time. But I need you all to know the church has never been closed, only our buildings. I have seen the body of Christ, the church, do incredible things during this time of pandemic in many creative ways. Now, that being said, reopening the building for worship service is going to take some time, some planning, some patience, and a lot of prayer from everyone. I ask you to please be in prayer for our state and federal governments, for our Greater New Jersey Conference, and for myself and the leaders at Cookstown and New Egypt UMC. In order to reopen, both churches must develop a plan to address the 8 health and safety issues that I've listed here on the screen. The plan then must be approved by both church councils before a date to reopen can even be set. I know this may be disappointing for some of you, but please know that when we get back into the building, things aren't going to look exactly the same for quite a while. There will be many changes ahead, as your health and safety is our first priority. For now, June worship will be online. I am working closely with lay leaders Bill and Donna to be able to get recordings to those who may not have access to the internet. I ask you to please be patient as we navigate these new waters together as a family. I ask now that we would lift our voices in praise one last time before we close.
I believe in the sun, I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the world that never ends, because he lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the sun away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Amen.
Church, I was so happy to share the Word of God with you this morning and to share some of my story. I want to encourage you as you go out into this week that you would find time to share a story with someone else, a story of how God has impacted your life. We all have them, and it is one of the amazing ways that God has given us to share the gospel with other people and make disciples to transform the world. I look forward to hearing some of your stories as well. Be blessed and have an incredible week.